Last week we looked at amplifiers using two ports in general, deduced what the values of the two port parameters must be to make a high gain amplifier, and then we discussed the device which actually has these properties, which is the MOS transistor. Okay, so it has a, according to our basic model, 0 Y11 and Y12 and 0 Y22 as well, and some Y21 that depends on the operating point. Okay. And it turns out that both the MOS transistor and the bipolar junction transistor, which is the other popular device, are both well described with Y parameters. That's why I started off with them. Okay. So now the next challenge is to actually build an amplifier using a MOS transistor. Okay. We know that in principle it can be done. If you have a voltage controlled current source, if you load it with a resistor, you get some gain, and that gain will be GM times RL, where GM is the proportionality constant of the voltage controlled current source and RL is the load resistance. Now we actually have to set up the operating point in the MOS transistor, connect the input to it appropriately and take the output also. Okay. So that's what we'll do. We said that we have a load of 100 kilo ohm, and also our source has an internal resistance of 100 kilo ohms. Okay. So this is RS and this is RL, and what was the gain we wanted? 20, right? What did we say? 20. So we said we want a gain of 20. That means that across the load resistance, I want a voltage which is 20 times the input voltage. For now, we will not worry about whether it is plus 20 or minus 20. Okay, sine inversion is okay. So that means that if we do drive it with just a voltage controlled current source, which is our model for the MOS transistor now for small signal increments, then what we have to do is to connect the input to the gate, the source is the common terminal, and connect the load to the drain. So this will be GM times VGS. What should be the value of GM? What should be the value of GM? 200 microsiemens, okay, or 0.2 millisiemens. Now we do know how to get this 200 microsiemens. What do we have to do to the MOS transistor to have a transconductance of 200 microsiemens? What's the operating point? VGS of 3 volts. Okay. So if we do what did I say? I chose some value of VDS. That was also 3 volts or 3 volts. Okay, it doesn't matter. Basically, we have to apply a VGS of 3 volts and make sure that the transistor is in saturation region. Then it will have a transconductance of 200 microsiemens. Okay. And then of course, for it to be in saturation, the drain source voltage has to be more than 2 volts. Okay. And I have just taken 3 volts arbitrarily for now. That will have some implication on the design, but for now we will not concern ourselves with those things. Now the situation is this. This is some circuit with a control source that gives you a gain of minus 20, and this is the transistor when configured in this configuration gives you a transconductance of 200 microsiemens. Okay. So this is the real circuit, this is something. Okay. Now how do I connect the input and how do I take the output from this setup? I have to connect the input to the MOS transistor somewhere here on the picture on the right side, that is the total circuit, right? And I have to also connect the load resistance to that circuit. So how do I do that? So first of all, let's see, what is the gate voltage or gate source voltage? What is the gate voltage here? VI. Okay. And what's the gate voltage over here? 3 volts. And what should it be? After all, this is the incremental picture, right? So what should be the total? Source should be at 0 and this should be at 3 plus VI. Okay. So that's when the picture on the left side makes sense. Okay, after you take out the operating point, you will be left with an increment of Vi. Okay. Now, how do I arrange for this? How do I get 3 volts plus Vi? What is that? Drain. Where? No, no, I want to get 3 volt plus Vi at the gate. What should I do? I know how to connect 3 volts, I know how to connect Vi. So, how do I connect 3 volts plus Vi? What is your suggestion? I didn't hear. Connect the drain current through what? Yeah. No, no, no. I have applied 3 volts here, and in this picture there is a signal source which is represented by this. Okay. So, to this MOS transistor at the gate, I need 3 volts plus Vi. Basically, I need a sum of two voltages. What do you think is a way of doing that? I mean, if I ask you to sum two voltages, what will you do? If I gave you a 1 volt source and a 2 volt source and ask you to get me 3 volts, what will you do? Connect them in series, okay? So, that seems like the easiest thing. Actually, we will later see that this is not at all convenient, but assuming that we can do this, I put my input source, which is Vi in series with RS, on top of 3 volts, okay, and I connect it to the gate of my transistor. Now the input side is fixed, right? The operating point VGS is 3 volts, and when the signal is non-zero, it will also get the input voltage on top of the operating point. Is it okay? Fine. Where? In RS. What is the gate current? Gate current is 0. So, there is nothing, this is just, no current is flowing through that. So, we are fine. Okay. Again, we assume that our frequencies are small enough that no current flows into the gate of the MOS transistor. Is this okay? Everyone agrees that this gives you 3 volts plus Vi at the gates? Okay. Now, what is it that is required for the output side? First of all, the drain voltage has to be more than 2 volts. Okay? That is for the transistor to remain in saturation. Agreed? Right? It doesn't have to be connected like this. However, I just connected 3 volts here to illustrate that this will be in saturation. But it doesn't have to be like this. Whatever it is connected to, the drain voltage must end up at some value. The operating point value of the drain voltage must be more than 2 volts. Is that right? Okay. Then, where should the load be? The load is connected between drain and source. Okay. So, how do I combine these two? So, let us say I want the operating point drain source voltage to be 3 volts, and I want the load resistor RL to appear like this in the incremental picture. So, what should I do? Yeah. Okay, in series with the voltage source. Any other suggestion? Parallel. Will that work? Will this work? What happens? What's wrong with this picture? Yeah, so? What happens to the incremental picture? Yeah, that's a minus 230 volts increment there. So, what happens in the incremental picture? I think you still remember the. Yeah, there basically.
RL will appear between drain and source, but obviously now this is shorting out the load. This is as good as having RL equals 0. Okay. Fixed current source between any two nodes.
could be any other circuit. And that functionality is basically the small signal linear functionality. In this case, it's just an amplifier. The output should be 20 times the input or minus 20 times the input. So for that, we know the incremental picture, and we also know what operating point must be there for the what operating point must be set up in the MOS transistor. Okay. So now we have to combine these two pictures, apply the input and output as required by the incremental picture while keeping the operating point. Okay. So the way to do that in this basic amplifier is to connect on the input side. It's easy because the gate is drawing no current. All I have to do is to connect the input, the source that sets up the operating point in series with the input source. Okay. And you get exactly what you want, 3 volt plus VI at the gate of the transistor. The source is of course grounded. Once it's grounded for both the incremental picture and the operating point picture. And here I wanted 3 volts across this. Under those conditions, 200 microamperes would be flowing and RL is 100 kilo ohms. If this was the case, then this has to be equal to 20 volts. So that means that this source, that is basically this source is there to have the bias on the drain side, right? It is there to provide the correct VDS so that it remains in saturation region. This is 23 volts. Okay. So I'll just redraw this the way it is normally drawn. Why is what? Oh yeah, it is. Yeah. Why? What is the issue? Oh, that we'll see. I mean, there's the rest of the course to deal with that. Already this is too many, right? For a single amplifier, you have this DC source and that one. So for your radio, maybe you will need like 500 batteries. So we can't use this circuit as it is. We'll see how to do that. Okay. Now, the operating point here is 3 volts. The operating point there is 3 volts, and the operating point current is 200 microamperes. Okay. What is the increment at the gate? It is equal to the input source voltage VI. And what will be the current when you have this incremental input VI? It will be the same. Still be 200. Huh? Yeah, what is the small signal increment? Plus? What is the value of the incremental picture? Why do we have, what is open? Yes, what is it? Why did we, what is the utility of the incremental picture here? Why do we have that? What do we do with the incremental picture? I mean, we can make calculations on it, but what do we do with it? What do we do with the resulting numbers? Ah, exactly. So the total solution equals the operating point solution plus what we get from the incremental circuit. Okay. So if I have VI here, what is the incremental drain current? Yeah, it's GMVI or 200 microsiemens times VI. And what is the incremental drain voltage? What is the voltage like this in this polarity? Minus 20 VI. Okay. So now, if I set VI to 0, okay, I will have 3 volts there, 3 volts there, and 200 microamps there. Everybody agrees with that? Okay. So now you tell me what each of these quantities is when I also add Vi, which is non-zero. What happens to the gate voltage? It will have the operating point plus the increment. What happens to the drain current? What is that? Same. Why? So what will be the drain current? Same from? No, I know, but so if I have Vi equal to 0, I have 3 volts here and 200 microamperes flowing from drain to source. Okay, so now Vi is not 0. Okay, so the gate voltage becomes 3 volts plus Vi. What will be the drain current? How much? How would you calculate it? Let's say this was the first time you were looking at this and you knew MOS transistor characteristics. How would you calculate this? Now, let's say you didn't know anything about the small signal increment and all this stuff. All you knew was the MOS transistor model and you are given this circuit. How will you calculate this? No, I mean, I told you that you don't know anything about incremental stuff. Where does Y21 come from? What is the MOS equation? No, this is extremely important. There is some basic confusion here. What is the current here? Plus times Vi. Why? Why do we superpose? I mean, in fact, we split the total input as the operating point and the small signal increment, and it's because small signal increment we can superpose. By the way, if I gave you this from scratch, what would you do? You would calculate this as mu n C aux by 2, assuming that it is in saturation, which you yet have to verify. W by L, 3 volts plus Vi minus the threshold voltage, 1 volt square. Okay, so this is the drain current, and what is that going to be? Mu n C aux by 2 W by L. First of all, you will have 2 volts square, and then what are you going to have? 2 times 2 volts times Vi, I will write it like that, plus Vi square. Okay, now what are the 3 terms here? What is that? Exactly. That's exactly correct. So this, the first term is, this is what we do, right? Of course, we don't want to keep on doing this for every circuit. We just simply slap the incremental equivalent of the MOS transistor in place of the MOS transistor and carry out our calculations. But this is really what we are doing. This gives us the operating point. This product will be 200 microamperes. And this product here, what is that? That is mu n C aux W by L times 2 volts times Vi. And this is nothing but, what is that? Transconductance GM. No, it's not times 2, this 2 and that 2 cancels. Okay. So this product here is the GM. Okay. So it is GM times Vi. And finally, we have Vi square. We assume that Vi is small enough and we neglect this. Okay. So this is what we do, but we can't do this for every circuit. First of all, the exact equations may not be, I mean, maybe too cumbersome. And when you have more than one transistor, we'll just die anyhow. So we don't want to carry out these things. So what we do is simply, we know that for increments, there is a linear relationship. So there is a linear equivalent circuit. So we replace the MOS by the linear equivalent circuit. And what that does is that gives us only the terms excluding the operating point. Okay, the operating point is not given by the incremental picture, that you calculate separately. So now, what is the answer? So here, this is whatever is added to this is really the drain current that appears in the operating point picture. Okay, so essentially I have, let me modify this picture to show exactly the same circuit that we have. Okay, So I have some VGS here, that is the incremental small signal VGS, and I have some operating point VGS there. Okay, let me call it VGS 0. So the total VGS will be VGS 0 plus VGS. Similarly, I have some operating point ID which I call ID 0. I have some incremental ID which I denote with lowercase id. So the total drain current would be ID 0 plus ID. In general, any node voltage or any branch current will be the operating point node voltage or operating point branch current plus the corresponding quantity in the incremental picture. Okay. So if you do this, if you do this business of putting down the equations with the nonlinear characteristics everywhere, cancel off the operating points and neglect the higher order terms, this is exactly what you will get. Okay. So please, I mean, this is extremely important because this is the utility of the operating point picture. I mean, sorry, the small signal incremental picture. The small signal incremental picture depends on the operating point, but it's much easier for calculations. So when you want the total currents or total voltages or total anything, you want to, you have to take the operating point quantity and add it to the incremental quantity. Okay. So this will be 200 microampere plus 200 microsiemens times Vi, and this 3 volts, what will that change to? 3 volts minus 20 Vi. Okay. So that means that if you let's say it was 3 volts and this Vi is 1 millivolt. So the actual input here is 3.001 volts. Okay. So what does this mean here? The drain voltage will fall down by 20 millivolts. It becomes 2.98 volts. Okay. So there is a gain of 20. That is, for an input increment of 1 millivolt, the output increment will be minus 20 millivolts. So that's the meaning of having a gain which is minus incremental gain, that is minus 20. Okay. Is this clear? So it's only in the incremental sense that this will have power gain. Okay, you can see that now for an increment there is a much larger increment in the output. And similarly, if you calculate the change in power from the input side and the output side, you could have power gain from a device like a transistor. But in real sense, of course, the transistor is always dissipating the power. Okay. Any questions about any of this stuff? Okay, so we now have our amplifier and it gives a gain of minus 20. What else is there to be done? Why do we need the rest of the course? By the way, it's common to denote this source as VDD because it's the supply that is used to bias the drain side. Just conventionally, that thing is called VDD. Okay. This is in our case, and this gives us a gain of minus 20, right? And it looks like by changing RL and by changing the operating point, we can get different gains. Okay. So, what problems do you see with this amplifier? Or are there any? VDD is too high. Okay. Fine. That's one problem. Then, two batteries. I have a 23 volt and a 3 volt battery. And looks like the voltages of these batteries will be totally arbitrary, right? Depending on the design, we'll have all kinds of voltages. Then, huh? That's correct. So that's what I said. So the supply volt, these battery voltages will be kind of arbitrary in the sense for each stage there will be some different voltage and so on. Okay. What else? That can in general happen anyway. That possibility is always there. Why would it go out of saturation region? Yeah, that's right. So that is always there. That possibility is there, and we have to pick the right operating point. Okay. What else do you see? We can't load the output. Okay, that could be a problem. I mean, you can't connect the resistor like that. Is that what you mean? Yeah, so this will first of all change both the operating point as well as the small signal picture. Okay, so let's leave that for later. But there are many circuits like that which you can't load, or if you load, some functionality will change. Yes. Connector. What is the equivalent of a speaker? No, I know, but will it be, will it be purely inductive? Can it be purely inductive? Why not? It's a coil, Yeah, obviously it has to be, in fact, ideally it should look like a resistor because first of all, it is driving real power out, right? It is moving the air molecules. So real power has to be going in. So there has to be a resistive part of the impedance. This is a total aside, you are saying that instead of RL, we could have, let's say, an inductor. Now, it is possible, and we will in fact come to that. But one thing is, what is the advantage of using an inductor? So let's say instead of RL, I'll use an inductor. What's the advantage? Why are you advertising an inductor? No, we can surely analyze this. Okay. So one thing is that there is no DC drop across an inductor like there is in a resistor. So in that sense, it is definite advantage, right? Because what is the DC drop across the inductor? Zero. Right? You can't have DC across an inductor. What does it mean if you connect a fixed voltage across the inductor? What will happen? I'll draw this picture. What happens? 1 volt and L. What is the problem? What short circuit? Why infinite current? What will happen if you do this? You won't get? Charge. Why? What happens if I do this? This is perfectly legal, right? We have done this in EMC so many times. No, I'm talking about this is an ideal inductor. Okay, if there is a resistance associated, I'll scribble that as well, but that's not there. What happens if I do this? Let it run out. What do I care? What is wrong with this picture? What will happen? Just tell me what happens electrically, that's all. There is no change of voltage, so let it be. I am not interested. Current keeps increasing, so this doesn't reach steady state, okay? It's in steady state that you can't have a DC voltage across an inductor. You can perfectly have, what's wrong with this picture either? I can have 1 milliamp and a capacitor. What happens now? The voltage goes on increasing, okay? There is nothing wrong with this. And this will happen, and if you assume that there are ideal components, it will go on increasing till T equals infinity. Okay, it doesn't reach steady state. So it's only the steady state DC current DC. You can't have a steady state constant current through a capacitor, and similarly, you can't have steady state constant voltage across an inductor. Okay, if you do that, it won't reach steady state. That's what it means. Okay, what is the time constant of this circuit? Yeah. Give me the value. What is the time constant of this circuit? Infinity. Capacitor times the resistance across it. It's infinite. The other one is also infinite. So that's what is wrong with it. That's all. Okay. There is, in principle, of course, in reality, the inductance will have some resistance and the battery will not be ideal and all that stuff. But as far as just circuit theory is concerned, it's just that these circuits won't reach steady state. Yeah, they have time constants which are infinitely long. But anyway, that's completely besides the original suggestion that he made, that we could have an inductor here. If we have an inductor, all that happens is there is no DC voltage across. And when I said no DC voltage, I obviously implied steady state. Okay, that's why, if you do have a DC voltage, then the currents are constantly changing and we have not reached steady state. That's clearly not a situation that we would like to have. Okay. So we can have an inductor, so that means that the drop is zero. So this voltage can be reduced substantially, okay? But what is the problem with using an inductor? Again, circuit wise. What happens to the gain? You can't have? No. Depends on frequency, okay? It becomes frequency dependent, right? What will be the gain at very low frequencies? What will be the gain at DC? Zero, okay, because the impedance of the inductor is zero at DC and it goes on increasing as you increase the frequency. So again, in some circuits you may want this, but for now let's assume that we don't want this type of stuff. Okay. If what is in series with RL? Ah, okay. Yeah, absolutely. No, it will, right? I mean, instead of RL, okay, in this incremental picture, let me have some impedance. I mean, it can be resistor, inductor in series with resistor, only inductor, anything else that you want. What will be the voltage here across this? If this is GM VGS, what will be that voltage? Minus GM ZL VGS. Okay, now I can't use this, I have to use phasors. Okay, to legitimately write that, I have to use phasors. Of course, it can have inductors. If it has inductors, it will have whatever effect the inductor will have and so on. But the point is, it will be frequency dependent, and that's something that we don't want right now. Okay, so we have to stick to a resistor. And also, it doesn't still solve the problem of having multiple voltage sources. Okay, so we have to fix these things. Now, there is yet another. So the problems are that, first of all, we have multiple voltage sources. The secondary problem is one of them seems to be very high, but that we'll deal with later. And the other problem is this VI and RS, okay, it's not really a voltage source in series with a resistance, okay, it's a representation for some input signal, whatever the input signal there is. Now, it's clearly not going to be some structure with two terminals which you can stick in series with something else, okay. For instance, what could it be? It could be the output of another amplifier, okay. So, it is just a representation for what comes before this. So, what that means is that really you don't have both of these terminals accessible to you, okay. You have to ground one of these things, okay. So, although we write VI in series with RS, it is implicit that the bottom terminal, I mean, there is a this VI in series with RS, this voltage here is available with respect to the common ground or the common reference node of the circuit. It is not really a voltage source in series with a resistance which you can stick in series with something else, okay. You can't do that. So, that is also a serious problem because that breaks down the entire circuit. Is this clear? No. So, minus points are multiple DC sources. So, this VIRS is only a representation, okay. It is not really a voltage source in series with a resistance with both terminals accessible. For instance, it could be another amplifier just like this one, okay. This is the common ground of the circuit, and this is the previous stage, this is not this stage, okay. So, the actual output which is the input to this stage is available between these two terminals. You certainly can't take this and stick it on top of something else, okay. So, the point is this has to be ground referenced. Yeah, but I mean, first of all, we don't want to use this kind of multiple batteries in the first place, right? Isn't it? I mean, we don't want to stick batteries everywhere, we want to have signals. I mean, I don't know, how many batteries do you have in your mobile phone? 500 or 1? So, you have to derive whatever you have, want, how many ever reference voltages you want, you have to derive it from a single source. Okay. And this is just one amplifier, this is a tiny, tiny, tiny part of a complicated circuit that we all use, okay. Yeah, which may or may not be appropriate, you don't know, okay. That's actually a good point. I mean, it comes from a previous amplifier and that has some operating point voltage across it. In fact, that is a problem, that it's the operating point voltage of one amplifier output may not be compatible with what comes I mean, what the following one requires. Okay. So, at least, I mean, I hope you are convinced, but if not, just take it from me that we don't want multiple DC sources, because we will have many, many amplifiers and we can't have these arbitrary valued voltages. Okay. It's also not easy to make arbitrary valued batteries. Yes? Which one? Yeah, because this is just a representation of, so let's say we have, I will represent an amplifier like this, okay, or maybe, yeah, this is just basically a two port. This triangle is just to show that the left side is the input and the right side is the output. So this is just a two port and this is the common terminal, okay, this is the input, this is the output and this is the common terminal. The output is available between the output and common terminals, okay. Of course, between these two you can always represent, just like you can represent any linear circuit with a source as a Thevenin equivalent which has a voltage source in series with a resistance. But clearly one of the terminals is the common terminal of the circuit, so that means that it has to be connected there, okay. So you can't take this and put it in series with something else, okay. Fine. So this is clearly a problem and both of these we have to solve, okay. Now for now we want frequency independent gain, but actually we will see that's not strictly true. We will use frequency dependent components, but at least in some range of frequencies we want frequency independence, okay. So how do we go about doing this? First let's take the easier problem. Just to set up the operating point, I needed two batteries, okay. Let's first try and reduce that to one, okay. So we have to establish a quiescent VGS and VDS. For establishing quiescent VGS, we have this 3 volt source, and for the quiescent VDS, we have this source which we call VDD, okay, 23 volts. So now, the first thing that we can try and do is obtain one from the other, okay. Is this fine? That is, I mean, I have two DC voltages here. Even if you can afford two batteries, go with me for now and then assume that you want to reduce this to one, okay. So now, which one is easier? Is it easier to get 3 volts from 23 or 23 from 3? 3 from 23. Anyone thinks the other way is easier? No. Okay. No, if you did, you should go to power electronics. I mean, you need a lot of things of this kind because you have voltages coming from the solar panel which is widely variable and you want higher voltage or lower voltage or whatever it is. Okay. So, how do you get 3 volts from 23 volts? What should I do? How? Use what? Resistive divider. That seems quite easy. So, what's the voltage that's appear? That'll appear here. Huh? What is the voltage that appears there? 23 R2 by R1 plus R2. So if I change the ratio R2 by R1 to some appropriate value, I can get 3 volts. Okay. So is this also a useful technique? I mean, let's say I have a toy that works with 3 volts, I mean only 2 batteries, and I have only a 9 volt battery. Can I do this? Can I use a resistive divider? Okay, let me rest. That's okay. The kid is crying. I can't worry, be worried about wasted power. Okay. Okay. So this will give you 23 volts times R2 by R1 plus R2 if this current is 0. Okay. So if there is some load, what will be that voltage? Huh? Minus or plus? Minus? How many say plus? Nobody. How many say minus? Nobody. Okay, minus what? minus IL R2 R1 parallel R2. Please apply superposition properly. It's not R1, it's not R2. Yeah, if you have IL alone, this 23 volts is a short circuit and R1 is across R2. We go and evaluate this. So minus IL R1 parallel R2. Okay. Usually, actually, this question every year I have seen that it takes me much longer to get to this answer. Everybody says IL R2. Good. So it is minus IL R1 parallel R2. Okay. So you can't use this with loading, or you have to make sure that R1 and R2 are so small that this power wastage becomes very large. Okay. Essentially, what happens is that the current here must be much smaller than the current that was flowing there for the voltage not to change. Okay. So anyway, that's again a general aside. So can we use this for our circuit? Exactly. In our case, at least, the 3 volt is required to bias the gate, which is drawing no current. Okay. So we can use this resistive divider without any problem. Okay. So first of all, here also you can make this change. This is the change in voltage because of loading. You can make that very small by making R1 and R2 very small. But the point is, then a lot of current will be flowing through there and it will waste a lot of power. Okay. We'll see. Yeah, we'll see how to fix that. That's the next problem. We'll keep having problems. That's why we'll have this course and the next one and the next one and so on. So every circuit will be unsatisfactory in some way. That's why I'm still doing circuit design. I took this course, I don't know, 95 or something. So yeah. Capacitive divider. Will it work? Actually, that's an interesting idea. Why would you want to use a capacitive divider? No loss. Okay. What will be the voltage there? C1 by C1 plus C2 times 23 volts. Guaranteed. Under any circumstances? No. This is all we have. I mean, is there any condition under which I could get a different voltage there? Which is also DC? No, okay, let's forget. Exactly. So this kind of thing is highly dicey to use. Okay. So you have to make sure that the initial charge on this plate is zero. Okay. The capacitors have to be reset. So without that resetting arrangement, it could drift to some voltage. Okay. So it can't be used to reliably. This capacitive divider cannot be used reliably like this without either resetting the capacitor or having some other means of ensuring that the charge there is zero. Okay, so we can't use a capacitive divider like that. So fine, in our case we can use a resistive divider. That is, at the very least, we can set up our operating point picture with a single DC source. And R2 by R1 plus R2, I can set this to be of any ratio. This is 3 volts by 23 volts. Okay. So now I have set up the operating point. Please think about how to add the input to this. And remember, the input has to be like that. Okay. And finally, at the gate, I want 3 volts plus VI. Okay. Please think about how to do this. The only thing I would say is, maybe perhaps VI is also not DC, but it has a certain frequency, some signal frequency. Okay, because I mean, for instance, if you take audio, it will have a certain minimum frequency. So you can think of it as a sinusoid of some frequency. Okay, think about it. We'll continue from there tomorrow.